Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I'm going to pray, and then I'm going to give you a mini word, and then I'm going to pray again and give you the word of the Lord for today. Is that okay?
Sure.
I'm going to time myself, too, because I don't want to be too long, because I know people only have limited attention span. So, Father, we come to you in Jesus' name, and I just thank you. Let's just go before the Lord together right now. Father, I thank you, and we just come into your presence right now by your grace. And Lord, I thank you for just every person here who's been washed in the blood of the Lamb, who's been saved, who's been sanctified, and set on the path of righteousness, the path of the way that's made by the gospel, what you did, Jesus. And Lord, I just thank you for revelation this morning. And Lord, I just thank you for all that you want to speak in this next 2 minutes as I preach a mini word in Jesus' name. Amen. So before I get into the word, I really felt like there were some of us. I actually had a vision this morning, and I saw this wall in front of many of us. And I feel like there's a number of us who are feel like, how do I progress? I feel like I can't progress in this thing called the faith, in my relationship with God. And I don't know what it is, but I feel like I'm being held back. Is that anyone here this morning? Just, okay, so that's like 25% of us, and then another 10%, 20% that didn't raise your hands. So it's probably 50, because there's always those that are like, well, I don't even know. And that if you don't know, then that's a wall in and of itself, because you don't know what you're doing. You're not progressing. So one of the first books I read as a Christian, actually the first Christian book I read, other than the Bible, was a book called The Pilgrim's Progress. And who has ever read The Pilgrim's Progress before? A great read, and it just opened my eyes. And I said, God, I want to be a believer that progresses. I want to journey with you, God. I don't just want to go to church. I don't just want to, you know, do the Christian thing and be a Christian in name only. But I want to actually walk the walk. Amen? I don't just want to talk the talk. I want to walk the walk. And I want to be an example. And whatever, however you would lead me, God, that's what I want to do. I want to actually progress in my faith. So in my journey in progressing, I started hitting walls as a new believer. One of the walls was my own pride. Who's ever faced that one before? I wanted to lift my hands in church, but I thought, well, what is other people going to think about me? Amen? And I just felt like, wow, I wanted to dance. Like, in my spirit, I'm like, and I felt God saying, dance, dance. And I'm just like, oh, what about everybody else? They're going to look at me. My pride. Is that anyone here this morning? You want to worship, but you feel held back by your own ego and your own pride. And so I learned, man, I just got to lay that thing down. I've got to practice laying down my pride. I remember one time, it was like I was in this meeting. There were thousands of people. There was this evangelist from Argentina. It was at Toronto Airport Church. And I just felt the Lord saying, shout, just shout. And I'm like in the seat, and he's like, the preacher is saying, If this could break through, there could be a revival that happens right now. But I felt this fear of man and this just a blanket the whole building. And I just wanted to shout, but I couldn't get it out. And I just realized, man, there's stuff. There are walls of pride and ego and fear and lust and this stuff that seems to be holding me back. And so I started to say, God, what is the key to break through? And I read in Proverbs chapter 1, verse 1, it talks about how the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And so I went on this journey trying to understand, God, what does that mean? Does that mean I'm afraid of you? What does that mean? And I learned what it really means is that I put God before and of everything, before my feelings, before my fears, before my pride. I place his voice and his leading before everything else in my life. Amen. So that means if God is saying it, it comes first. I practice, and I would push, and I would exercise my faith, and I would practice putting his voice before everything else in my life. So what I've learned to do is to live my life in the light of the judgment seat of Christ. Now, the judgment seat of Christ is actually a good thing. Everyone say good thing.
Good.
If you're not a believer in Jesus, you haven't received his forgiveness, The Bible talks about a judgment called the Great White Throne Judgment. And in that judgment, God will separate the believers, the born-again believers, from the ones that aren't believers. It's literally the separation of heaven and hell for eternity. This isn't my words, this is the Bible. I don't understand it. I don't understand the fullness, the full scope of God's divine justice, but I believe the word. And I believe God's big enough to keep this word pure. And although we, you know, are still learning and still grasping and still trying to understand everything. So that's the Great White Throne Judgment. But there's another judgment called the Judgment Seat of Christ. And that's the judgment for believers. And really what it is, James, it's a dispensation of the rewards of God. Really what the Judgment Seat of Christ is whatever you did in the grace of God, in the Spirit of God, whatever you did in this life to partner with the Holy Spirit, God will reward you on that day, and for eternity, that reward will be yours. So it's called an eternal reward. Who here likes rewards of the natural? Amen. Let me give you an example here. This will show us how carnal-minded we are. Now, I've got some money. I got a $20 bill. 20 bucks? It's really nothing. Like, it's great. I mean, these days, 20 bucks. Let's sweeten the pot a little bit here.
Let's go up right away.
What do I got in here?
Do I got any red ones?
Let's make it 40. Carly's mask. My money anyway. Yes, that's not being recorded, is it? I got 40 bones, 40 bucks, two green ones. Really not that much. I mean, I can't even take my wife out to dinner for 40. I can go to McDonald's. But I can't even take my wife out for a nice dinner for 40. It's only 40 bucks, it's nothing. Who here wants this 40 bucks? Okay, well, I've got some things for you to do. Who wants it? Come on up. Just one person. Who's first? Brandon, all right, there it is. It's over. I need you to do 10 jumping jacks. Wow, this is embarrassing. Oh, geez, everybody's looking at you. Everybody is looking at you right now. All right, do 5 push-ups.
Oh, no. I can't.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5. All right. Now, get on your knees. Pretend you're a dog. No, woof, woof, woof.
Woof, woof, woof.
Do it again. Oh my gosh, this is so embarrassing. All right, one more thing I can make you do. I want you to shout at the top of your lungs, Jesus is Lord.
Jesus is Lord!
Okay, that wasn't the top of your lungs. That's the top of your lungs? Are you in pain right now in your lungs? Or? Like that's because if I were to yell it, I would be like 5, 6, 7 times louder than you. And I know I got a voice, but why don't we try one more time in the mic?
Jesus is Lord! All
right, give this guy a hand clap, he's your 40. Now, 40 bucks, Canadian dollars, is nothing. Well, it's something, but it's really not that much. You say, was this just a thing? Did I really give him $40? Yeah, because I'm trying to make an illustration. 40 bucks. Now, I'm sure he would have done that for 5. But 40 bucks is nothing. But we are talking about eternal reward. I don't know about you, but one of the reasons I live the way I live is because I know that there is a judgment seat of Christ. I know there is a day that I will stand before Jesus and I will give an account for every day that I lived. Now, that's not the judgment seat where he punishes me. Jesus has saved me from that. Amen?
Amen?
He died on the cross to save me from eternal condemnation or eternal judgment. But the judgment seat of Christ is where Jesus looks at you and looks at every moment that you've lived and says, now this is your reward. One of the things that stirred my heart, my father actually said to me one time when I was a young Christian, he said, well, those guys in China, they're going to have great rewards compared to, like in heaven, judgment seat of Christ, compared to us in North America. And I remember as a 17, 18-year-old getting on my knees and saying, God, I want to be like those guys in China. I don't care what it takes. I said, God, do a work in me. And I was this immature. I love Jesus, but I was immature. I didn't have much faith. I didn't really know the word. But I just said, God, I'm going to give my life for this gospel. Because I'm living for eternity. I'm not living for this earth. Jesus says he talks about money a lot in the Bible. I don't know if you know that. But Jesus talks about money more than he talks about heaven and hell combined in the New Testament. Did you know that? Jesus talks a lot about it. Why? Because money is so close to our hearts. For some reason, especially in our culture, materialistic culture, we glorify money. We're like, some of you are still thinking about that $40. Man, if I had just gone up there quick. Mark's just seething over there. $40. Jesus said, you can't serve two masters. They're talking about money and God. He said, you will either love one and hate the other, or you will cling to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money. Now, this is not Pastor Josh trying to get money. I've got lots of money. God has blessed me beyond what I ever thought he would, to tell you the truth. I'm not going to say what he's doing, but he's just blessed me monetarily. And so I've become a greater giver than I ever have in my life. Because, not because, now I could hoard it and keep it, and I could have paid off my house by now, and then some, easily more. Like if I had kept it all to myself. But then what does that do? What does it do for people? What does it do for the kingdom? What does it do for the purposes and the commission of Jesus? Even to be here and just to keep operations going, like, we need about $8,000, and it all comes in. God has always provided for this church. But there's some of you that you're holding back on God, not just money, you're holding back your life from him because you don't see the benefit of the fear of the Lord. You don't see the benefit of living your life in the light of the judgment seat of Christ. You don't understand that the decisions you make now, like Maximus said, echo in eternity. They ring, and I don't believe they just echo, I believe they shout in eternity. So we have saints that have gone before us that are in, the Bible calls, a great cloud of witnesses in heaven, looking at you, cheering you on, cheering your progress on, cheering, saying, break through that wall. Get over that hump. Get over that fear. Get over that ego. Get over that materialistic spirit, that mammon spirit that we cling to. Breakthrough. Progress. See, some of you need a breakthrough. And it actually is. Now, this you might not understand this. And my prayer is that the enemy would not be able to use this to somehow think that, because people say a lot, the church is just about your money. But those aren't people that are serving in church and really love Jesus. Those are people that have been offended for some reason. They've been offended because some preacher pricked a sore spot on them. Amen? Some people, that's what good preachers do. If you never get offended at my preaching, I'm not preaching very well. To tell you the truth, that's an anointed word right there. I feel the fire of God on that. Let me say it again. If I'm not offending you on a semi-regular basis, at least pricking you, pushing you a little bit, then I'm not doing my job. What's a preacher supposed to do? What does a good coach do? He pushes you. He gets you to do things that you don't want to do so that you can get the results that you want to get. Amen? That's what a good coach does. He pushes you to do things that are hard so that you can get the results that you want to get. Amen? I've got a great coach. His name is Jesus. He told my wife and I, give 20% of your gross income and then some. You're looking at me like, oh my gosh, that's pretty radical. I live my life in the light of the judgment seat of Christ, and I live my life for eternity. It's only money. We give thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars. It's money. It's just money. But the reward is heaven. Jesus said, Jesus said, do not store up for yourself. You can read it in Matthew 6. Money where thieves will break in and steal, rust will, what is it, how does it go again? Do not store for yourself, let me just go there, because I can't remember word for word. James, go there with me for a second. Some of you guys are getting really pricked right now. I love it. Because you need it. Because some of you, actually the Lord was ministering to me, some of your wall, some of you in this room, is a lack of finances. Oh yeah, some of you guys, you're on the poverty level. But it's because you're so materialistic. It's because you don't trust God. It's because you hoard everything for yourself and you don't plant into the kingdom what he wants to get to you. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, I was going to read, God gives seed to the sower and bread to the eater. In other words, everything that you get, all the money you get from God, some of it is seed to plant into the kingdom and into people's lives, and some of it is for you to eat. And for me, God has given me certain percentages. I don't know how he's going to work with you. But when we eat our seed, we destroy the potential of the blessing that God wants to give to us. It's not that he doesn't love you. It's not that he doesn't favor you. It's just there's a process. It's called sowing and reaping. The reason this church exists is because there's a preacher sowing the word to you every single week. I hate to say it. Well, obviously, we have a lot of volunteers. There's a lot of things that make it happen. But one of the main things is there's a preacher who's willing to get up and sow words into you and sow his time and sow the gospel week after week. Look like a fool sometimes. But I don't care. I'm going to keep sowing. And I'm going to keep reaping a reward for my toil. Amen. We are the laborers in his vineyard. Matthew 6, verse 19. Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves, look at this, treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. You know why a lot of people aren't, their heart really isn't in church? Because they haven't put their treasure in church. Your heart follows your money. Whatever you invest into, your money and your time and your gifts, that's where your heart is going to be excited about. So if you're not giving and if you're not sowing the seed that God has put in your heart to sow, you're not going to be excited about a move of God. You're not going to be excited about being a part of the kingdom if you're not sowing into the kingdom. Am I talking to anyone this morning? This is some of your wall. You need a breakthrough. Because God wants to get to you. He doesn't want to take away from you. Yeah. But he wants you to trust him. Yeah. And for some of you, I'm prophesying, it starts with a tithe. Beginning to give God 10%. That's what tithe means, 10%. Beginning to give God 10% of your income back into your local storehouse, the church, that you are receiving spirituality, you are receiving the gospel from, you're receiving fellowship from. And God wants, now we don't even need money, like we're actually doing really good. But God wants to get to you. He doesn't want to take away from you. You got to get that. Amen? Oh, Jesus. I know I'm challenging some of you right now because you're materialistic. I'm sorry to say. You can be offended. Good. Some of you need it. And I love you, but that's what a good preacher does. Is that okay? Am I? Some of you are like, I'm not going back to that church. They just so. I don't know. Pastor doesn't want the money. Which is a lie. I don't even care about money. I care about you progressing in your faith. And Jesus cares about you progressing in your faith. Amen? Amen? Okay, I'm going to preach this next word. That was like the pre-word. And I'm just going to preach the next word. It's going to be a shorty, but it's going to be a goodie. You guys ready?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you for this word. Let's sort up there. Line in the sand, part one. And Jesus, I ask you just to speak. I thank you, Lord, that people can just shelf the last thing I said, especially if they're feeling really stretched right now and offended at me, that they would just be able to lay that down and receive this word. In Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to set my timer because I want to get better at this, because sometimes I just tell jokes and go off and on. 30 minutes. You guys ready?
Yeah.
Line the sand. Part one. Some of you guys are still, I could just feel in the atmosphere, some of you guys are still like, I wonder, about that word. Pastor wants the money. The devil is a liar. Line to Sand, part one. I subtitled this word, and we're going to do three parts, but power reveals that Jesus is the Christ. And my thesis for this word is to prove that the biblical way to win people to Christ is through the power of the Holy Spirit. The biblical way to win people to Christ is through the power of the Holy Spirit. Open up your Bible to Matthew 11, or you can look at it on the screen. Matthew chapter 11, verse 1. Matthew 11, verse 1. I'm going to preach for a bit. I'm going to share some of my personal story. I only got 28 minutes and 47 seconds to do it. So, because I preached two words today, but the Holy Ghost wants me to. Matthew 11, verse 1. When Jesus had finished instructing his 12 disciples, he went on from there to teach and preach in their cities. Now, when John heard in prison, now John is talking about John the Baptist. Now, John the Baptist came before Jesus to prepare a way for Christ, and he preached a message of repentance and was baptizing multitudes. And so the king in that time didn't like it, and he threw him in jail. When John heard in prison about the deeds of Christ, he sent word by his disciples and said to him, saying to Jesus, "Are you the one who is to come, or shall we look for another?" So, in other words, John was saying, I know my purpose was to prepare the way for the Christ. So, I'm in prison right now. And by the way, prison back in the day, back in those days in Judea and Israel, was not like Canadian prison. They didn't have TVs. They didn't have bed sheets. They didn't have, like, social time playing Scrabble and stuff with other inmates. It was like a dungeon, okay? They were in a wet, he might have even been in stocks. Stocks were when you had your hands and your feet in the, you know what I mean? You couldn't move. I mean, it was like torture, prison. It wasn't nice. And John, I feel John the Baptist had a sense, I'm probably going to die. So I want to know, are you really the Christ? Have I fulfilled my purpose? Because if you read about John the Baptist, he had a very specific calling, which was to prepare the way for Jesus. So John wanted to know, have I fulfilled my purpose? Are you really the Christ, or shall we look for another? In other words, do I have to bust out of this dungeon, bust out of this prison, and prepare the way for the real Jesus, or shall I look for another? And so this parallels a lot with what people look when they look at a church, or they look at preaching on YouTube, or they walk into the church and they don't know much. A lot of times, even subconsciously, people are saying, is this the real deal? Some of you have asked that question. Is this the real Jesus? Or shall we look for another? Is this the real Jesus? Look what Jesus said. Jesus answered them, "Go and tell John what you hear and see. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear, and the dead are raised up, and the poor have the good news preached." So Jesus said, go tell John this proof. Everyone say proof. This proves that Jesus is the Christ. This was the proof he gave to him. Go tell John the things that you see and hear. This is the proof that I am really the Christ, the Messiah. This is the proof that you can just chill. Don't worry about it. I know you're in prison. You're about to have your head cut off. But just relax. You've fulfilled your destiny. You've prepared the way for me. I'm really the Christ. And I'm not just saying to you, I'm a good guy and I'm preaching good things. I'm a moral person. So come to Jesus. No. The blind see, receive their sight, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear, and the dead are raised up. And the poor have the good news preached to them, and the poor is all of us. And blessed is the one that is not offended by me. Blessed is the one who is not offended by me. So I believe those disciples went back to John and said, listen, this is what he said. And John went, job done. Why? Because there was power. Oh yeah. Jesus proved himself to the world through power. As we're going to read, as we're going to look at in the coming weeks, the disciples, the apostles of Jesus in the book of Acts and all through history, the church grows by when the power of the Holy Spirit is released. And that, what often happens is signs and wonders and miracles. So, as a 19, 20-year-old, I've been living for Jesus for about 3 years. And I really wanted to reach people. I had a burning desire to see people saved because I saw so many people just so broke, busted, and disgusted. They needed Jesus. Amen? I look at the world around me and I'm like, dude, you're totally doing this thing called life wrong. Like, life is supposed to be about Jesus. And when you give your life to Jesus, he starts, you know, in a process as you're following him and there's progress, things get good. Now, sometimes you got, I mean, all the time, you got to rise up and be the person you're called to be. You can't live in fear like we talked about. You can't have pride and all this huge ego and still follow Jesus wholeheartedly. You got to lay all that stuff down and follow. But when you do, things begin to get good. They get better. They really do. Now, sometimes in like other countries, you just get killed. But then it's all good because you're in heaven. Some of you guys are like,
doesn't sound good to me.
Well, that's because you're too earthly minded. I love you. But actually, Paul said, for me to live is Christ. To die is gain. In other words, and Jesus said, he said, don't fear man, who all they can do is kill your body, and that's it. That's all they can do. They can kill your body. Rather fear God, Jesus said, rather fear God, who could throw both your soul and body into hell. But he won't do that, because he loves you. And even the number of hairs on your head are all counted. And if a sparrow falls to the ground, he knows it. He will take care of you, because he loves you. Have a reverence for God. Rather revere God. So I started to realize I've got some work to do as a believer. And it's not to argue people into the faith, but it's to bring people a demonstration of God. To bring people the power of the Holy Spirit. And so as I was musing and thinking on this, the Holy Spirit came upon me and he said, you need to call your church dunamis. And I'm like, God, who's going to come to a church, really, called dunamis? And everyone gets it wrong. They're like, dudamis, dumas, dumas. And I'm like, no, dunamis. Dunamis is the Greek word in the Bible for power. We're going to get into that in the coming weeks. Dunamis is the Greek word in the Bible for power, and it means the demonstrative, the tangible power of God to heal the sick, cleanse lepers. All the stuff that Jesus did, he did by the power of God. So I got to the point in a realization, because I had talked to so many people and I had done so much evangelism, and I tried. Now I have an extreme value for things like the Alpha program, which we may be launching as soon. I have an extreme value for knowledge and the knowledge of God and the knowledge of the gospel. And I believe many people can come to Christ through an anointed message in the knowledge of the gospel, but it has to be coupled with the power of the Holy Spirit for a number of reasons. One, people have needs. Guys, the people that are walking into this church, some of them are sick. And they don't just need the knowledge of God, they need a power experience stand with the Holy Spirit and God healing them. And I tell you, they have a much better chance of staying following Jesus if they get healed by the power of God than if they just get some knowledge about how good God is. God is good, but he doesn't want to heal you. That's not the gospel. That wasn't the message of Jesus. That wasn't the message of the apostles. That's not the Bible. God is good, and he wants to heal you. In fact, he's so good. Here, take a little of this. Bam. Pray for them. See the power of God. So I began to take the gospel of power, on the streets. as a 20-year-old. I would go out, and I would just find people to talk. Now, this is my journey. This is what I did. Is this what you want me to do? Yeah. Oh, that'd be pretty cool. Well, don't you think it'd be pretty cool if 100, we've about 100 people connected to this church. Don't you think it'd be pretty cool if 100 people connected to this church every week said, I'm going to pray for someone this week? Because you all run into people every week that say, oh, my sore hand. Oh, my sore back. Oh, my sore hat. I got a headache. Oh, I got a migraine. Oh, this. Oh, that. Oh, this. Oh, that. And you say, can I pray for you? Yes. And they might go, you crazy, but okay. Oh, you're one of those. Yeah. Listen, if you're not willing to be one of those, you're following the wrong guy. I don't want to be one of those. One of those crazies. Can't I just go to church and kind of exist in my own comfortable bubble? You can, but you're not going to have much impact. You can, but you're going to stay stagnant. It's one thing to receive the Holy Spirit. That's good, and I want you to receive. We go on encounters, we receive, and we do a church, we receive. You're receiving right now. It's one thing to receive. It's a whole nother level when you begin to give God away. That's right. This is what the essence of this thing is all about. David said in Psalm 62, he said, one thing I know, two things I'm certain of. You can read the Bible. David's like describing God. He's like, one thing I know, actually, scratch that, two things I'm certain of. You, O God, are powerful. And you, O God, are loving kindness. Mm. Love and power. Why would you step out and pray for someone with a headache to demonstrate the power of God to them when they get healed? You know what I've learned about faith? Even if I step out and pray for someone to get healed, and they don't get healed, it still demonstrates the love of God and the power of God. Because there is somebody willing to step out on the water. There is somebody willing to step out in faith and just go for this thing. There are people out there, they need a demonstration of the power of God. Some of you are getting nervous right now as I'm talking. You're like, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. I don't know if I can do that. I don't know. And listen, you can, but Jesus can. All your job, all Peter's job to do was to step out on the water. That's all he had to do. Jesus didn't say, Peter, walk on the water in your own strength. He said, Peter, come. You guys know the biblical account. What did Peter do? He stepped out of the boat while 11 were like, what the heck is this guy doing? Peter stepped out. I want to see the replay in heaven. Because I bet you Peter did it with fear and trembling. I bet you Peter wasn't like, okay. Peter was like, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. Jesus, I'm on the water. And he began to walk on the water toward Jesus. And then Peter was like, oh my God, I'm on the water. And he looked down and he began to sink because he took his eyes off Jesus. But thankfully Jesus took him when he was about to go under. Jesus took him, pulled him back out, and said, you of little faith. Little faith? He just walked on the water. But Jesus is like, you'll get there one day, son. You'll get there one day. So I began this journey at 20 years old, and I began taking the gospel on the streets, and every person that I would evangelize to, I would just walk up to people all the time. I actually still do. I'd walk up to people and say, I just want to tell you that Jesus loves you, and he has a plan for your life, and then I'd see where it goes from there. What I would do is I would step out on the water of God's grace, James. I would step out on the water of God's grace, his anointing, and I would see, is there going to be a flow here? Because all I can do is step out on the water. I can't preach the gospel without the anointing. On Sunday mornings, I tell you, I'm buzzing the whole time because I feel the power of God on me. This is how I preach. This is the only way I can. Otherwise, it's just dead religion. If I'm just going to write a word and I'm going to, just read it off a page or something, that can be good too. But if it's not anointed, if there's not a flow of God, his presence. So sometimes I'd walk up to people and it'd be like, nothing. And it'd just be like, and I realized the reason is because their hearts are closed. I would go and I'd try to preach to them, try to share with them, but I'd realize their hearts are closed to the gospel. So I'd say, bless you, I'd give them a dunamis card, and I'd walk away and find someone else whose heart was open. Because I can't preach to a closed heart. Neither can you. Amen? Somebody has to be able to receive. Otherwise, it's like giving someone a gift and their hands are closed and in their pockets and they just won't take it. So you can't do that very well. But I'd find people that were hearts open. In fact, I got to the point where I'm like, I just need to like get more people. So I'd walk up to groups of young people. And like 10 guys at a skateboard park. I'd be like, hey guys, what's up? And I'd just be like all like that. Be like, who are you? And I'm like, I'm Josh Pitka. They're like, oh, we've heard of you, Jesus Jr. And like, I'm like, wow, that's a great compliment, actually. Jesus Jr. I like it. Who wants to be Jesus Jr.? Some of you? Come on. Even if you're like, okay, I'm crazy, I'm never coming back here, but who wants to be Jesus Jr.? Just indulge me. Just wave your hand in the air. Jesus, help us. I want to be Jesus Jr. Anyway, I thought it was a great compliment. And I'd say, does anyone here have any pain in their body? And they'd go, yeah, buddy just busted his ankle. And the guy's like, well, I don't want prayer, that's weird. And I'd be like, listen, I guarantee, this is what I used to say. Now, I don't necessarily endorse this, but I'd say, I guarantee God will heal you now, or I'm a false prophet. And they go, I don't even know what a false prophet is. And this is youthful zeal, maybe not a whole lot of wisdom, but I'm saying, God, I'm putting you to the test. Man, this is what your word says. And I'm just so sick and tired of seeing all this powerless Christianity around me. Where's the power of God? Like when Elisha received the mantle from Elijah, he struck down the mantle and said, you know, Elijah just went up and Elisha received this mantle and he struck the river and said, where is the God of Elijah? And the rivers parted. And Elisha walks through on dry ground. You can read in the Bible. 2 Kings chapter 1 and 2. Power. That's power. Moses puts his rod in this. In, you know, the children of Israel are trapped between the sea of, what is it? Which sea was it?
Red.
The Red Sea. And Egypt behind them. And there was a pillar of fire blocking Egypt. And a sea in front of them. And Moses cries out to God. And God says, why are you crying to me? I've given you power. God said to Moses, why are you crying out to me? Put your rod in the sea. And so Moses puts his rod in the sea, and the sea splits. And the children of Israel walk through on dry ground. What is that? It's power. That's power. That's dunamis power. It's to save, to heal, to deliver. So I prayed for that young man right there. And I remember it so clearly. There was about 10 kids around, and I said, I took his hand, I said, in the name of Jesus. And I would just wait, stand up. I would wait, because I realized it's the power of the Holy Spirit. I mean, I can like get down on my knees and pray for things, sometimes I do. But I just realized this is power, this is the power of God. So I just, oftentimes when I pray for someone, I'll just take their hand. Because I'm like, it's just virtue. It's like, you know, remember the woman with the issue of blood? She had an issue of blood for 10 years, spent all her money on doctors, nobody could heal her in the Bible. And she said, she saw Jesus and said, if I could just touch the hem of his garment, I will be made well. So this woman, stand there for a minute, with an issue of blood, see, I'm just flowing. This woman with the issue of blood made her way through the throng, made her way through the crowd, and just touched the hem of his garment. And Jesus, the Bible says, perceived that virtue had went out of him. And Jesus looks around and says, who touched me? And the disciples say, you can read it in your Bible, the disciples say, man, this is a throng, like hundreds of people pressing in all around us. What do you mean, who touched you? Everybody's touching you. He said, no. I perceive virtue has went out of me. And then the woman was like, oh, I've done something bad now. And she's like, it was me. And Jesus said, looks at the woman and says, be of good cheer. Your faith has made you well. Be of good cheer. Your faith has made you well. This is like a conundrum to me, because this miracle was not even on the, it wasn't even on the list. Jesus knew everything he was doing. He knew what, and she hijacked a miracle. She hijacked a miracle. She came to Jesus and she stole the power of God out of Jesus and gets healed. And Jesus is like, you awesome. And I'm like, can I hijack miracles for other people? I want your ankle to get better. And I just say, what I learned is I never pray for miracles because Jesus never prayed for a miracle. What do you mean? He never prayed, oh God, in your divine mercy and in your benevolence, Lord, heal this person. Not once. The disciples didn't do it either. You know what they did? In Acts chapter 3, when they walked by the lame man, they're begging for money. What did Peter and John say? Silver and gold we have not for you, but what we have, we give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And the man leaps to his feet and he starts dancing. What we have, we give to you. Everyone say that with me. What we have, we give to you. This is what the power of God is all about. This is our inheritance, to be able to give Jesus away. Give Jesus away, Julie. Just give him away. Give him away. You know why? Because he starts to increase in you. It's actually the lose it, the use it or lose it law of the anointing of the Holy Spirit. It's actually got to do with a lot of spiritual stuff. But if what you use increases in you. So I would say, in the name of Jesus, I release the power of God. And I would say stuff like, Lord, because I knew that the Holy Spirit was substantial. I'd say, let the power of God just come. I command that ankle to be healed and restored in the name of Jesus. And then I just wait. And I just say, all the Holy Ghost, all the power, all the virtue inside of me, I just would give it to this guy. This guy's crazy. I want to be like Jesus. I still do this all the time, at least like almost once a week probably. Because I bump into people all the time. I'm like, I'm going to pray for you. I walk right up to my customers. I'm like, I'm a Christian. I've seen lots of people healed. Can I pray for you? Just say it like that. And then I just give them what I've got. And many times you sit down and go, in this instance, the kid goes, oh my God. He actually said like cuss words and stuff, you know. Beep, 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 beep. Oh my God. And they're like, and all the kids around, is it better? Is it better? He's like, yeah, right. And they're all like going crazy. Yeah, right. Now I've learned like that it doesn't stop there. Because a lot of young people have grown up in broken homes and they're just broken. They're broken people from broken homes. And they'll go home, and I've seen this happen many times, they'll go home and their parents will talk them out of what happened. I've just seen it happen, but it doesn't negate the fact that we're called to do it. We're called to release the power of God everywhere we go. You'd be surprised how much your life will enhance, how much your Christianity will enhance, how much your relationship with God will enhance when you begin to give God away. Give him away. Give him away. Oh, Jesus, I only have 5 minutes left. You got to give him away. Where do I want to go? I'm just going to tell a few more stories. I've got more scripture to go over, but we'll put on pause because I really felt to be faithful to a time frame today. I remember praying for so many people and nobody was getting healed. And I was just like, God, what's going on? And then I read a book called Power Evangelism by a guy named John Wimber, who helped to start the Vineyard Movement, the Vineyard Church back in California in the late 70s. And he said, he got saved at age like 33 or something like that. And he said, and he read the book of Acts, it was like the first book he read. Then he walked into church and said, "What is this? This isn't what I just read." And he got a passionate resolve to see the Bible come alive in his generation. So he just started praying for people to get healed. His mindset was this, and this became my mindset. And I encourage it to become your mindset. He said, "I'm going to pray for 1,000 people to get healed. And if nobody gets healed, I'm going to pray for 1,000 more. Because God's word doesn't change based on our experience." Amen?
Amen.
His word doesn't change. James, you just sent me a big text. How am I supposed to read this?
Yeah, read it later.
Read it later, okay. It's like you just sent me a novel. Jesus. And so his testimony was he prayed for 1,000 people. And you know how many got healed? Like 5 or 6. Out of 1,000. Why? Because faith is something that has to be exercised. Now I'm not saying it's going to be you. Because I prayed for 1,000 people. You know how many I've got saw get healed? Probably about 50. 1 out of 20. And I was mad. I was like, "God," so I started fasting. I did a long fast. And I was just pressing in. And then I had an encounter with Jesus. And you got to understand, like, I'm not one of those guys that just falls down under the power all the time. There has to be, like, I try to stand. When somebody's praying for me, and I come from charismatic circles, and everybody's falling everywhere, getting on the power, whatever. And I'm like, when a preacher comes to pray for me, I, like, want everything God has. So I'm like, I need to stand, and then he'll lay his hand on me longer. But if I just go down, when someone goes, "Tip," and everyone's going down, and I'm like, I like get the stance, right? I don't know, you can do what you want. But I believe I can only minister in an anointing that I can stand in. So if the power of God gets strong, I'm like, "Oh, stand. And then he goes away, I'm like, and I'm just buzzing. Like, I feel the same power of God and the same impartation. We can talk about all this stuff. This is all biblical stuff. That everybody else feels, but I'm like, I just want to stand in it. Hallelujah. Leslie, I'm going to stand in this anointing so I can pray for people. I can't be like, could you imagine praying for someone and just going to heal them? And you're like, and then you're under the power. You got to be able to stand in God's presence and in God's power. So, but one time, I was at Bethel, it was a revival service, and Pastor Tim prayed for me. And he's an anointed man. But it was just, there was a flow of God, and I was actually with Kyle Lepers, and he prayed for us, and I flew backwards. It was like a bolt of lightning, like the lightning of God just hit me on the top of my head, Mark, and I just went flying backwards, and I'm like, I got up after a few minutes, and I'm like, whoa. I just received something. And I thought to myself, I better go give it away. This is what I'm like, I just received from God. Okay, let's go give it away. So the next day, I met with my friend at Tim Hortons, a buddy that I was trying to minister to. I met my friend at Tim Hortons, and he wasn't there yet. And in Tim Hortons, I saw this guy with a cast on his arm. And I'm like, praise the Lord, opportunity. Oh yeah, opportunity, right? It's opportunity. I get my coffee, he's walking out the door, I chase him out there, and I say, "Hey," and he turns around and I just say, "I would love to pray for your hand." He goes, "Well, no, thanks." He goes, "I'm a free thinker." I'm like, okay, I don't know what that is. Not that smart. But can I still pray for your hand? He goes, okay. And so I prayed for his hand, and I grabbed his hand, like, just lightly, and I tell you, that same lightning bolt from the night before, I felt the power of God just, and I'm like, I'm vibrating, and I don't know what this guy's thinking. This guy's, like, on crack. I'm vibrating, and I can feel the virtue and the power of God coming out of me. And like attacking this guy's broken wrist. And I go, and afterward I come, like it's like I got sucked up into heaven for a minute. Okay, I'm going over time. I got sucked up into heaven for a minute. And I come back down, I'm like, "How's your arm?" That's exaggerating, a preacher exaggeration. How's your arm? And he goes, still feels the same. I'm like, no! Let me pray again. I pray for him again, nothing. I'm like, God, what is it going to take? Like, do I have to, like, get hit by 50 bolts of lightning for you? I'm sitting there having coffee with my buddy, and the guy comes, about 10 minutes later, he walks into Tim Hortons. He walks up to me. He says, what did you do to my hand? I said, what do you mean? He said, I was driving down the road, and I felt the pain leave my hand and come out my fingertips, and I'm totally healed. Can you give Jesus a hand clap? This is what happened. I'm totally healed. He said, and then he said, what power is this? Verbatim, that's what he asked me today. What power is this? I looked, I said, Jesus. It's Jesus. Then he said to me, what can I give you? I said, $10,000. I said, nothing. I said, you don't have to give me anything. I said, just get to know this Jesus. He's the one who healed your hand. And he sits down with us, and we converse for a while, and I think he was from Abu Dhabi. I don't know where he was from, Malaysia or something like that. I don't know what he was doing in Sarnia. But the power of God, not man's life. You know what that is? Line in the sand. That man will forever remember that encounter with Jesus, and the next friend or person that says, come to my church and meet Jesus, he'll be like, the same Jesus that healed my hand? Okay. I believe I'll see that guy in heaven, and he's going to thank me. Because I remember getting home that day and getting in the shower, and I said, thank you, God, thank you, God, thank you, God. And then the Lord just spoke to me. He said, no, son, thank you. I said, thank me? He said, yeah, if you hadn't have stepped out, it never would have happened. We are called to co-labor with Jesus. He doesn't do everything. Revival, if you want to see revival in this church, it is 100% God, totally. It's 100% God, but it's 100% man and woman. God wants all of you so you can labor with him and bring the gospel to this world, bring the gospel to this city. In your personal prayer life, in knowing Jesus, in stepping out in faith, in just going after the things of God. And see, this is where the warfare begins to happen. You think you've faced warfare before? Start to bring the gospel out. Yeah. Really start to fight. Really start to see your faith. Leslie had an awesome testimony a couple weeks ago. She shared, and I'm like, yeah. Boldness. Boldness. It's 11:45. Hallelujah. Can I share with you one more story?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm over time, but Jesus, help me. Forgive me. We were going around. I remember, I went to England to preach, and we saw mighty miracles over there, all this stuff. And I actually felt to invite this young guy that I'd really connected with to intern with us. His name was Seb for short. You would have loved him.
Well, I miss Seb.
You miss Seb. Yeah.
Why didn't you bring him up?
So, right before Seb came, I was having an encounter with Jesus in my bedroom, just loving Jesus, and his presence came into my room. And Jesus said, for the next 30 days, I want you to talk to 10 people a day. And I said, whoa, that's a great challenge. 30 days, 10 people every day. Now, yeah, I'm not saying you have to, but this was for me in a season, and I didn't have any other job, I wasn't working, I had every day to go tell people about Jesus. So I said, okay. It was like 9:00 at night, and there was a thunderstorm outside. It was raining, raining cats and dogs. And I'm like, okay, we'll start tomorrow. And the Lord said, no, tonight. Lord, it's raining outside, and it's like 9:30. Like, where am I going to find people? He said, just follow me. Get in the car. Start driving down the road. He says, turn left, turn right, turn right, turn left. Turn left again. I drove down to Arrow Road, turned left on Arrow, then turned left on Indian, and I see hordes of young people coming out from a dance at Northern. So I get out of my car, and I start witnessing to people in the rain. This is just what I did. You know, you can do what you want. But I just was like following Jesus. start witnessing to people in the rain. It was awesome. A couple days later, we're driving around, me and Seb, trying to find people to preach to, trying to find people to witness. We get out of the car, we talk to this one guy, and, I forget his name. I don't remember. We get out of the car, and he says, "Can I have a ride to the vineyard? I'm volunteering." And actually, just after that, we met you. And so we drive into the vineyard, and we're telling him about God, we're witnessing him a little bit. We get out of the car, and we realize he's got a really sore back. He's actually on medical marijuana for his back. And I just say, "Hey, can I pray for you?" And he goes, "Sure, pray for him." Same thing, his back's totally healed. It's awesome. And then I realized, he said to Seth, "Well, I'm blind in one eye." "You're blind in one eye? Like totally blind?" He said, "Yeah, totally blind. 3 years ago when I was 16, I skateboarded off a one-story car park, tried to make a land, and I bashed my head. So somehow his optical nerves got separated from the rest of his brain nerve and whatever. And he was blind in one eye, completely blind." I said, "Well, God just healed your back. Let me just pray for you." He goes, "Okay." I put my thumbs, and this isn't glorifying me, I'm just telling you a real story. Put my thumbs in his eyes, and just felt that same electric power of God, virtue, dunamis, power of the Holy Spirit, till the point that I'm like shaking, and I'm like, "God, you're doing something." Step back, opens his eyes, he starts cussing, because he's totally, completely healed. His blind eye, that was blind for 3 years, totally blind, pops open. The power of God heals this guy's eye. This is just my stories. Don't you want to have stories like this? Who wants to have stories like this? Like real stories. One more quick one. I'm in Pakistan, so we'll be quick, because you can watch the video, actually. The video's online. You can actually watch it. There's a 2.5-hour video on the second night I'm in Pakistan, and I preached my heart out. And then people start getting healed. And we just prayed en masse over this crowd of 8,000 people in Pakistan. And security all around is dangerous. But for me to live as Christ, to die as gain, so even if I got blown up, you know, I didn't want to die a virgin because I wasn't married yet. But I was like, if I die, I die. If I die, I die. I'd rather obey God. My life is not worth anything to, I tell you the truth, my life's not worth anything to me if I don't obey Jesus. What's the point of living on this planet, Margaret, if I'm not going to obey Jesus Christ? Right. The one who saved me, he got me out of drug addiction, he got me out of the hole I was, he set my feet upon a rock, I'm going to live my life for Jesus. I'm living for Jesus. You're weird. That's great. So was Jesus. So were the apostles. But they shook history. And the Lord is calling our church to shake a city and to shake a nation. That's what I believe. I believe that. God speaks that to me all the time. But it's not going to be one dude doing it. It's going to be an army of people that are in love with Jesus, that love Jesus more than their comfort and love Jesus more than their lives. So we saw, you can watch the video, either that night, I think it was 2 or 3 girls, that young girls, 14, 15-year-old, born deaf, completely deaf from birth. Jesus popped their ears open. And they were hearing for the first time. I was like screaming, going nuts. Could you imagine? Who wants that in their little miracle belt? Jesus. I want to encourage you guys. I know that many of you are struggling and you're fighting the good fight and you desire to go forward. You desire to make progress in your life. And so these three messages starting today are, I felt like the Lord saying, it's time to get back to the root, Mark, of why you're doing this church. And Dunamis Church exists so that people may know Christ, but not just know the knowledge of God, but know the power of God. And so I want to challenge you and encourage you, if you felt like, man, I've received something from Jesus. You know what I learned? If I want God to do more with me, I've got to use what he's given me. Hallelujah. All I have is a cup of water. Give it away. all I have is a little bit of anointing. Tell someone that Jesus loves them and just go for it. Amen. Just go for it. Bring them to church. Have a testimony. But there's no testimony without a test. You gotta push through your ego, your pride, your self-preservation, your fear, and you've gotta get that word in you. I'm telling you, if you're saying to me, Josh, I just don't even know this Jesus, well, get to know him. What I did, I just read my Bible every day and listened to worship music until his presence just came in the room. I would seek God until I found him. Seek God until you find him. Be encouraged. Be filled with faith today. Stand up to your feet. I want to pray for you. And we'll close this message. Can you guys give Jesus a hand clap? He's so good. We follow Jesus. Jesus, that's for you. For you. All for your glory. Just open your hands right now. If you just want to receive a fresh anointing from God. From God. From God. From God. From God. Open your hands right now. Open your hands right now. Father, I ask that you would just touch right now every person under the sound of my voice. It's not me, it's just your presence, it's your power. Lord, fill our church, I pray, with your power. Fill our church with your spirit. Lord, fill our church with wisdom. Fill our church, Lord, with revelation. Even the ones that couldn't make it today, Lord, fill them. Touch them right now. Touch them right now. Jesus, let virtue come out of this place. Let miracles begin to happen like never before. Lord, I want to prophesy, and I just want to make a declaration that we are going to see miracles like never before on the streets, in public places, in restaurants. Lord, stretch us, grow us, stretch me, grow me, bend me, do whatever you need to do. Let the gospel be preached again in our city. Let the gospel be preached again. Some people won't like it. We know that. But some people will be saved, and some people will be healed, and some people will be in church next week that we never thought would be in church because of the power of God. Lord, let that power just come right now. Lord, I just pray right now in the name of Jesus that any depression or stuff or fatigue that people are facing, lift it off right now by the power. Even let miracles go right now. Let healings happen right now in Jesus' name. I speak to that back and I command it to be healed. I speak to that wrist and that knee. I command them to be healed. Let your healing power just go out right now in Jesus' name. Grab your neighbor's hand for a minute. Grab your neighbor's hand. Grab your neighbor's hand. Grab your neighbor's hand. And just begin to pray. Just close your eyes. Forget about the person next to you and just begin to pray. If you pray in tongues, pray in tongues. Just begin to pray. Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, come. Jesus, let your word go forth. Come on, church, pray. Pray. I'm stretching you right now. I'm stretching you right now. Just open your mouth and begin to say Jesus. If you don't know what to say, say Jesus. 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 Let boldness just come into this house. Let virtue come into this house. Lord, break every lie of the enemy, I pray. Spirit of truth, come. Lord, let your light and your truth go forth into the hearts of every believer. In Jesus' name, amen. Over YouTube right now, just come, Holy Spirit. Just fill us with encouragement. Fill us with new life. Fill us with hope. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen. Now look this way. Look this way. I commission you to take this gospel and take this presence of God out of these four walls this week. I commission you. You're going to fail. Just to let you know, the enemy's already saying you're going to fail. Good. You're going to fail. You're going to fail sometimes. You're going to fail sometimes. You're going to pray, nothing's going to happen. You're going to push sometimes, and that fear might hold you back. But break through. Keep reading your Bible. Get revelation inside of your spirit and be the warrior God's calling you to be. He's calling you to be a Christian soldier, not just a pew sitter. Listen to me, not just a pew sitter, not just an average person, not just a moral person, but a spiritual warrior. Someone who presses through the fear of man and presses through the fear of woman and presses through ego and pride and lust and all of these things and pushes into a life of fruitfulness and pushes into a life of the gospel, pushes through materialism in Jesus' name. I commission you. In the name of Jesus. This week, I pray that, I declare there's going to be testimonies this week of the goodness of God, of the goodness of God. Some of you are saying, how is it going to happen? Don't worry about it. Just keep your eyes on Jesus. Put your eyes on Jesus and he will lead you. Am I saying you have to pray for someone this week? No. I'm saying put your eyes on Jesus and ask Jesus to give you an opportunity. And he will. If you ask Jesus to give you an opportunity, he will. I'm praying for opportunities this week, Mark. Opportunities. Who wants an opportunity this week to reveal Jesus to somebody? This is what we're doing. This is what this church is all about. Thank you for coming, sir, your first time, but it's no longer about you. Now it's about the lost. And I'm telling you, as you give away to the lost, you'll get more than you ever thought you could possible. This is what the gospel is about. You give it away and you get more. You give it away and you get more. You give it away and you get more.
You are so right.
Yeah, I know.
I'll testify to that.
Anybody in here that, and there's already one person that I know of, but anybody else that today is the day they need to give their life to Jesus? Just lift your hand right now. Today is the day I want to give my life to Jesus. Today is the day I want to give my life to Jesus. Wave at me if that's you.
Lift your hand.
One, two, you guys, that's awesome. Anybody else? Today is the day I need to surrender to Jesus. I just need to give my life to Jesus.
Don't be scared.
I need to give my life to Jesus. Amen. Pray with me. What's your name?
Rob.
Rob and?
Desiree.
Desiree? I've met you before.
Josh.
Huh?
This lady too.
Which one?
Did you have your hand up?
No.
Oh my gosh.
No.
Sorry.
Yeah. All good.
Sorry. I thought you were missing
them. So let's just do this. We're going to pray together and just support Rob and Desiree. Just everyone here close their eyes. And I'm just going to pray this prayer with you guys right now, but with everybody just supporting you. Just say this out loud. Say, Lord Jesus.
Lord Jesus.
Thank you for dying on the cross.
For my sins.
Right now,
I make you Lord
of my life. I receive your forgiveness. I receive your grace. And I receive your spirit. I'm born again because of what Jesus has done. I'm on my way to heaven. I'm sealed by the Holy Spirit because of what Jesus has done. Lord Jesus, I give my life to you, to serve you, to love you, to know you, to represent you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen, 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 amen. Amen, amen, amen. Jesus, Margaret, do you know these guys? Just stand up on the chair behind you. Get one hand on each. I just saw this in my spirit. Ask mom, bless you. You stand up right on that chair. Right on that chair. Right on that chair. Right. Put one hand on Rob, one hand on Desiree. Yep. Right on their heads. Holy Spirit, fill these guys right now. Just fill them with you. Just fill them with your fire right now. Fill them with your Holy Spirit. Seal them. Touch this family in Jesus' name. Touch this family in Jesus' name. Holy Ghost, be released right now. Lord, on our church and on Rob and Desiree. And I pray they would have the best week of their lives. Even if it's the most challenging week, I pray that it would be the best. Lord, give them Bibles into their head. Give them revelation. May they know you this week as they never have before. In Jesus' name. Amen.